everyone, and welcome to the 8th annual Mosaic International South Asian Film Festival, Misaff. My name is Arshad Khan, and I'm the festival director. Very delighted to have you all join us for this very, very special Q&A with the film team of Definition Please, a film directed by Sujata Day. We would like to begin by acknowledging the land on which we gather and on which the region of Peel operates. Misaff is located on the lands of the territory of the Mississaugas, of the Credit, and the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, the Huron-Wendat, Ojibwe Chippewa, and the Haudenosaunee peoples. The land that is home to the Métis, and most recently, the territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nations, who are the direct descendants of the Mississaugas of the Credit. We are grateful to work on this land. With me today is a festival advisor and formerly festival director, Anya McKenzie. Hello, Anya.
Hello, Arshad, and hello, everyone, and welcome as well to Misaff number 8, brought to you online, where you will be watching us safely from your homes across Canada this year. So I'm so delighted. Karai Boys and Greenwich Health, and I think that's it for the thank yous, but there are some government ones. There's Ontario Arts Council and Mississauga, City of Mississauga.
Absolutely, City of Mississauga. We also want to thank the Toronto International Film Festival, TIFF, for giving us their wonderful platform and helping us with our online festival this year. As well, we want to thank ACTRA Toronto and ACTRA Diversity for their support.
Excellent.
And now we're going to introduce you to our wonderful director, Sujata Day. Welcome, Sujata.
Hi, Arshad and Anya. Thank you so much for having us. We are so excited to have Definition Please. This is our Canadian premiere, so this is really fantastic. I'm here with my lovely and talented actors, Ritesh Rajan, who plays Sunny, and Anna Kaja, who plays Jaya in Definition Please.
Welcome, everyone. It is so wonderful to have you and this beautiful film. Usually, we would have had you on our red carpet with a lot of fanfare and our crazy parties. But unfortunately, because of COVID-19, we're unable to show you the hospitality that Mississauga has to offer, and we don't have a chance to get you wasted. Sorry about that. But what a movie you have made, Sujata. What a great accomplishment. This is your first feature. It's done so well. It is such a beautiful film. Our audiences are absolutely loving this film. And, you know, I've talked to some people who've actually, other people also who've watched it and absolutely raving about this film. Please tell us a little bit about how it came about. And I understand this is your first feature, right?
Yes, this is my first feature. I'll take you all the way back to fourth grade when I won my class spelling bee and I went on to regionals and I lost in the first round on the word radish. I spelled it with two D's instead of one. Pretty devastating. Oh, no. And then after that, I started being really interested in the ESPN spelling bees. And I would watch them every year and I would notice that it seemed to be a South Asian American kid winning the spelling bee. And even last year when we were all shooting in Greensburg, 8 kids won the spelling bee and 7 of the 8 were Indian American kids. So fast forward to 2015, I'm in a UCB comedy sketch writing class and we have to write sketches every week. And one of my sketches was entitled, "Where Are They Now? Spelling Bee Winners." And so if you Google the spelling bee champs of the past, they are all doing amazing things. They are winning world poker championships. They are working at NASA. They are probably working on the COVID vaccine right as we speak. And the button of my sketch was, okay, so one of these former spelling bee champs turns out to be a loser in adulthood. And so this was just like a really small 4-page sketch. And then in 2016, I went to the Sundance Labs the Sundance Screenwriting Labs. And once you do a screenwriting lab, you are considered an alumni of the film festival. So in 2017, I was like, I'm going to go to the film festival. And one of my friend Justin Chan's film Gook was premiering there that year. And I watched that movie. And afterwards, I kind of cornered him at his premiere party. And I was like, how did you get this made? It's incredible. And he was like, I just got my friends and family together, raised the money, and just did it on my own. And I was like, cool, that's what I'm going to do. So middle of 2017, I started writing the feature film version of Definition Please based on that sketch idea from UCB, and wrote the feature film, worked on the script for about a year, rewriting, getting notes. And then in early 2019, I went back to Sundance and Justin's other film, Ms. Purple, was playing there. And I was like, what am I doing with my time? I have to make this movie. So I decided to shoot the film in June of 2019. And that's when I really got the pre-production into action. And I started hiring crew, started texting my South Asian American friends about being in the film, and just put it all together, and we shot it last year, and now you guys are seeing it.
Wow, that's fantastic. Amazing. And I think it's really great that you went to these labs. How did that affect your script, and how do you think people can benefit from these?
Oh, the labs are amazing because actually, it was at a very interesting time because Trump had just won the presidency in 2016. And 3 days later, we had our labs. So we are sitting there in a circle doing our introductions. And I said my name and I just started crying because I was in such an emotional place because of the elections. Yeah. And then I think I opened some kind of emotional door for everyone because everyone else after me who introduced themselves also started crying. So it was a very therapeutic moment for the 12 of us that were there. And it was really nice to be around like-minded people who were really fired up to use our creativity to change the world, basically. Mm-hmm. And so that was a very specific thing that I personally got out of the labs in that time period. But we are also set up with different mentors, and I'm still in touch with my fellow lab mates that I did the lab with, and we would, you know, meet up at Sundance and, you know, watch a movie together or just hang out and get a coffee. And once you do any of the labs, you are just part of this really amazing family that's all about creation and authenticity and doing the work. So it's really, really just a wonderful experience.
Did you do any short films before that?
Yes. So I did Cowboy and Indian. You can see the poster. So Cowboy and Indian, it did the festival rounds in 2017, and it was really great. I wrote it, I produced it, I directed it, I starred in it. So it was a very good practice run for Definition Please, and all the jobs that I was going to be doing on Definition Please, I did on Cowboy and Indian on a smaller scale.
That's great. I mean, I'm curious, were you unique at the Sundance Lab as a woman, a South Asian woman there, or were there other people of color in the lab?
In my particular lab, I was the only South Asian woman, but then in a couple labs moving forward, a couple of my friends got in them. So like Tanuj Chopra and Mira Menon were in following labs, and they're good friends of mine. So I think, you know, I think they'd like to spread us out over the labs, maybe.
Sure. Yeah. Well, unique connection here is I can't believe I didn't meet you at Sundance 2019 because I was there.
Oh, cool.
With some of the Misaff team, and it was an awesome vibe at Sundance, and I totally can relate to what you were describing about their politicized programming and the socially conscious audience that attend Sundance and very supportive for new creators like yourself. So it seems like a great success.
Now tell us about your incredible casting process. Did you have these actors in mind when you cast them or what? Because they were so good. Oh my God.
Yeah.
They are so incredible. And I'm going to actually lob the question over to Ritesh and because I don't tell the story correctly or I don't remember it correctly because I'm like, oh yeah, I just texted a bunch of people and then they're in my film. So so that's not correct, but Ritesh, you can go.
Yeah, it wasn't as simple as sweet as that, but it was pretty close. Basically, I met Suge at a previous panel about Asians and South Asian artists in entertainment, and that's kind of where we connected, and she briefly told me about this script then, and then we reconnected because we did a parody together of A Whole New World called a diverse film. If you guys haven't seen it, check it out. And there she's like, yeah, I'm almost done with my script, and I was like, great, when it's done, just let me know. I'd love to help you out any way I can. And then she's like, hey, do you want to grab lunch? And I was like, oh, okay, cool. So I meet her for lunch, and then she's, you know, kind of persuading me with all these appetizers. We went to this like Chinese Indian restaurant. There's like egg rolls and samosas. And I'm like, what's going on? And then finally at the end of lunch, she's like, hey, I finished my movie. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome. And she's like, I want you to be in it. And so I was like, you know, obviously I was honored and I was flattered. And I said, you know, let me read it first. Let me do my homework. Make sure I'm doing the right thing here. And once I read it, I knew it was an incredible opportunity for me to be part of just a wonderful story and then also have the ability to just tackle such a multi-layered character and also, you know, talk about the stigma of mental health in sort of the South Asian lens and bring that to the forefront. So it was an immediate no-brainer to jump on board and work with Suge. So.
You bring a lot to the film. I mean, you have a very specific, you know, look and way of relating to people. And I really, for me personally, I really bought that you were like the son and the brother. And also that when you did the switch. Now, how did you prepare for this role? Because, I mean, you play somebody very complex with a mental illness.
Yeah, you know, I really wanted to focus sort of on the authenticity of the illness and how that affects individuals, and specifically in this film, how does a South Asian individual sort of cope with this, with the South Asian dynamics of like, hey, this is whatever, you know, push it away, because if it brings shame to us, we don't want to talk about it. And so for me, you know, I was really lucky. Both my parents are doctors. My dad is one of eight. Six of his siblings are doctors. All of their spouses are doctors. The majority of my
family business.
So, you know, I'm a failure and I went into acting. But I had a lot of resources, tons of friends in the medical field. I spoke to many psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, did a lot of reading. And sort of Suge and I, we came to the conclusion that borderline personality disorder was something that I wanted to focus on in terms of what the illness was, and really sort of pulling from authentic experiences and making sure that I was treating these moments with care and respect, because I really wanted people to see the struggle of the character, not necessarily the outcome or the anger, but really just that conflict. And what the sickness does is it creates conflict for everyone in the family between the, you know, his sister and his mom, and even internally. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was very, very well done.
Thank you.
Bravo.
And now I'd like to go to the mom, Anna. Tell us how you got cast in the film and how it was for you.
Yeah. So I think Sujata and I crossed paths a few months earlier at an award ceremony that we were both presenters at. It was for a theater company called East West Players, which is actually, it's a all Asian theater company, and it's actually the longest running theater company in the United States. And I think we met and spoke then. And then she offered me the role. I think it came through my reps. And I was flattered. And again, I was at first not hesitant, but I really was interested in reading at first, just because, you know, I found that when you play sort of people of color side characters or supporting characters, and in particular, me having played a lot of South Asian mothers, the roles can be a little bit stereotypical. They can be sort of all the same, and maybe not something that excites me that much anymore. Like I can predict it beat by beat. And I was so, And I was just so, I was kind of blown away and just so excited and drawn in by the role of Jaya. I'd never met anyone on page like her before, you know? And, you know, Ritesh was mentioning authenticity and individuals, characters. And that's how I see Jaya. I see her relationship with her children to be not stereotypical. And I find it to be very specific. I think that the way that she, you know, interprets the world through her religion, through her Indian culture, and through the Western culture that she's living in right now is unique entirely to her. And and that, I just found all of that really fun to play. And then I found her relationships with her children to be unique for each one, and just that there was just so much for me to dig into.
Unique yet relatable and yet believable within this world that has been created. And I thought it was a good reflection of the mental illness of the son and kind of a mental disorder of the mom, you know. I mean, she's lying to her family.
Yeah.
You know, and so often...
But a small fib.
It's something that we never discuss in our, neither in our families, within in our culture, nor in our media. And so I think this is a very interesting and timely film in that it's coming at a time when, you know, we are really stressed with COVID. Everyone's locked up in their homes. There's a lot of isolation. And so I think also the character that Sujata plays also feels a lot of isolation, not just because she feels like she has to take care of her mother, but also her brother, and also weight on her shoulders, you know, and then things flip. And, you know, I think that this film is very relatable in today's day and age, you know. So I think that's a very powerful statement, powerful film, and very important film for our time. And how has the reaction been for the people who have been watching the film, Sujata, or any of you?
Yeah, I mean, it's been really positive so far. And, you know, we get really funny tweets every now and then from people who've been watching the festivals. I think one of the most recent tweets was like, "Oh, well, didn't realize this film was R-rated." And then they're like, "But it's a super unique film. You should definitely watch it." And so that's the kind of response we're getting overall. And I know there's a lot of, you know, young brown girls that have been covering the film in terms of publications and reviewing the film. Mm-hmm. And they're really connecting to it. And they're
I think Anya's problem was like, the film has too many good-looking people.
Totally.
She's like, they cast like all the hot people like in LA. What is this?
So it's all Anna's fault.
It's my fault. Plus, Jaya just births really good-looking kids, you know.
Right. You have the Sujata's character is now going out with this beautiful Asian man. So can you talk about him? he's not up here right now, but that was kind of unusual. Like, we don't usually see...
Should we call him? Jake, where are you at, boy?
I actually asked him about being on this panel, but he's shooting...
Look, there's an empty square there.
I just wonder if that was intentional. Did you always want to have her dating an Asian person? And like, was that your intent from the start?
So in the script, Richie was written as every man. I didn't actually put the ethnicity in there. And there was a time when I was like, okay, so we know some hot like white boys. So should this character be white? And then it didn't feel right to me. And I wanted to just think outside the box for a second. And Jake, I had actually just met Jake at the same East-West Players event that I met Anna at. And And I was like, and we had just, we announced an award together. And I was like, oh, this guy is like perfect. He has a great personality. He's super good looking. And I was like, he can be Richie. And yeah, in the beginning, it was not meant to be a specific ethnicity. But once I met Jake, I was like, it's gonna be Jake. And it was really great because he was definitely one of those people that I texted and he said yes before reading the script.
Guys had a vibe since the award show.
Yeah.
It was all fake because I met Jake the next weekend randomly at a photo shoot that they did for like Asian men in entertainment.
It was like hot Asian men. He's not saying that it was like hot.
It was for mediocre looking Asian men in entertainment.
Speaking of
she
fate.
She said it. And then Anna, you could tell him.
Oh yeah, speaking of fate, I played Ritesh's mom on his television show Stitcher. So we knew each other long before, but Sujata cast me without telling Ritesh that she had cast me. So it was just a complete surprise.
Yeah.
Oh, that's very interesting.
So we had logged some bonding hours, some mother-son bonding hours.
I a lot of my ease of performance I owe to them because I was able to be just in a very, very safe space with the two of them taking care of me. So
it's amazing how everybody's vulnerability comes across so clearly and so well, you know. And also, I must say that I really like the use of your the music.
Mm-hmm. I had met Amanda Jones. She's a really talented young Black woman composer. And I met her at Sundance in 2019. And we stayed in touch. And she started working on, you know, bigger shows like Issa Rae shows, Lena Waithe shows, Ava shows. And I just reached out and be like, hey, would you want to do this film? And right away, sent her the script. She said yes. She started sending me songs even before we started shooting the film. And I was like, what's happening? This is incredible. And it was so awesome working with her because she was so collaborative, but really knew how to, you know, compose the songs the way that I was trying to describe what I wanted. And I would send her Bollywood songs that I liked. And of course, we couldn't use these particular famous Bollywood songs because of how much that would cost. And she just had this amazing ability to kind of, you know, make it a little bit different, but have that same emotional quality to it. And she reached out to singers in Mumbai that could sing in Hindi and Bangla and hired them for the songs. And so when we got the songs back, it was really great. And she would translate it into Hindi and Bengali through using Google Translate, but then she would send it to me. And the Hindi lyrics, I would ask my parents about because I'm not fluent in Hindi. But with the Bengali lyrics, I helped her kind of construct the lyrics of those songs because I wanted to make sure that that was all going to be right and that Bengali speakers and Hindi speakers wouldn't be like, no, that's not what you say, you know, but all of that is correct. And then I just really enjoyed getting songs from her and she'd be like, is this okay? Or do you want it more like this? And that was a really amazing process.
And how did you finance your film? Like, I know in the US it's very difficult for a lot of creators to fund their films.
Yeah, I'm really actually jealous of Canadian filmmakers and how they can get grants and stuff from the government. That would be nice, right?
No, we are really.
Can you imagine?
Really imagine grants, healthcare. There's a lot of things.
I know. So like I was saying, in 2019, I was at Sundance and I decided to make the film in June. And what happened was I had sold a TV show a year earlier and there was a Time Warner merger that happened. And so they emailed me telling me that they were going to give me back the rights to the show along with a huge check. So it was really crazy because I was at Sundance making all these plans to make my movie, not really knowing how to get started. And then I got this huge check and I was like, oh, well, this is part of the answer. So technically I was the first money into my film. And then after that, it was actually a little bit easier to get other investors and financiers on board once they knew that I also had skin in the game and that I wasn't going to try to like lose my investment.
Excellent. Oh, that's amazing. Sujata, sounds like you also produced the film.
I did.
Right. Yeah. So yeah. With all of those things, and you became the lead actress. I mean, was that also intended? Because it was a little bit autobiographical?
Yeah, that was completely intended. When I was writing the script, I made sure, like, I was going to play Monica, and I actually made sure when I was writing it that the Sunny character was going to have more, like, emotional things to handle as an actor, and I would kind of be reacting to that, because I knew I had so many jobs on the film that it would be hard for me to get to, like, an emotional state when I'm on set, because I'm thinking of location and food and making sure everyone's okay, making sure the cast and crew is okay. So I did that on purpose, to have Sunny and Tesh have all kind of the actual hard work. So yeah, it was always intended that I was going to play Monica, and I was always going to produce and direct as well.
That's absolutely insane. I can't believe it. You wrote, produced, directed, and you're acting in your own film. I mean, that's an enormous, enormous, enormous challenge. I wanted to know, what is it like when you killed your darlings? What is it that you left out that you would have liked to keep in the film? What have we missed?
Everything's in the film.
Wow. Okay.
Everything is. I'm trying to think about. I was super happy with the finished product, and you know, everything from the script made it into the film. And I was really happy with our cast and crew, and our post-production was really fun. You know, in terms of really positive experiences I had, we got to do our sound design at Skywalker Ranch and watch the film in the 300-seat theater. And I sat in George Lucas's seat while we were doing that. So that was a really special moment. And, you know, the entire thing, you know, I wish this upon every first-time filmmaker to have an experience like this, because it was really, really positive overall. And I know that's not the case all the time.
Well, Sujata, I mean, I remember asking you on set, I don't understand how you're doing this. and then, you know, because she'd show up and she'd have cast dinners with us afterwards. She was totally fine. And then she just seemed fine. Like, I think I asked you like seven times. I was like, but how are you doing this? Because you do takes with her and she's totally available and present as an actress. And then afterwards, she just goes right to the directing and she'll check in with you and everything. And but I remember you told me it's just about you prepared so much. Yep. I mean, every shot planned, everything prepared for every contingency, you know, so you could really just be present and relax. And I think that's it paid amazing. Off.
How was your rehearsal process? How long did you rehearse for and stuff?
Well, Anna and I, we didn't rehearse at all. But I had full faith in that she was going to, you know, come in and kill it. Tesh came over one day, I think, before we went to fly out to Pennsylvania. And I was just asking him to come over for like a very casual read of the script together, of our scenes together. And then he starts like fully emoting and bawling on my couch. And inside, I'm like, oh shit, I got to get it. Like, I was like, oh, he's like really bringing it. I got to bring it too. So then.
Oh my gosh.
I had the reverse. I was nervous. I was like, oh, this is like a full blown rehearsal. And I come from a theater background. So I was like, shit, do I need to be off book? Like all this stuff. Like, I was like, she's like going to test me? And I get
you know,
there and she's like,
You always feel a little bit like in a situation like that, like, you know, it's not an audition, but isn't an audition. Like, you don't want to leave there and have the director like, I regret my choice. You know, you like, go and kill it.
Yeah, because unless you're like locked in, it's always an audition, isn't it?
It's true.
Even a table read. Like I had a table read for my script and I couldn't believe some of the actors literally memorized their lines just for a simple first draft table read. Like some actors are really, really taking every step seriously. And I think that's really amazing.
Good. It's better that way than the other way. So
I did that I'm really proud of is I feel like I surrounded myself with a cast that was way better than me. So that shows. And I think everyone was just like brought it every single scene. Like we didn't have a ton of time to shoot or do like a lot of takes, but everyone brought it every single take. And sometimes in the editing room, it was like tough to decide which one we were going to use because they were all great.
Which of the two?
I'm so surprised.
Which of the two?
You got a 50-50 shot. We only have a second one because he messed up the line in the first one.
I feel like my entire experience on set was like, Suge, can I please have one more? Please one more. And she's like, we've got to move on. She's like, we've got it. We've got to move on.
Wow, that's amazing. But, you know, I'm from the time where in my film school, we had to, be very, very frugal because I worked with 16 millimeter film and 35 millimeter film. And so I come from the time when you really, really did just have two takes for many of the scenes. And it was very difficult. But now, also, I found that cinematography was very beautiful and good art direction and production design in your film. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, cinematography, my cinematographer was Brooks Ludwig, who I had worked with last year on another independent film called Blowing Up Right Now. And I was just only an actor in that. And I noticed that he, on that set, that he worked really well and fast, but could get great footage and great, you know, performances out of the actors. So when I was thinking about, you know, doing Definition Please, he's one of the first people that I went out to and I said, hey, would you be down to like come to PA with me and shoot this film? And he was super down. And so we had a lot of what we called movie dates where we watched different films and I would say, oh, I like this shot, or like I like how this feels. And we decided early on that it was going to be purely handheld. And so we watched a lot of films that have specifically handheld cinematography, like Wong Kar-wai movies, Monsoon Wedding. And so that was really important part of it because I knew on set we weren't going to have time for me to look back at footage. So I really needed to 110% trust my cinematographer in terms of what he was getting. Art direction and production design. So one of my friends from childhood, Caitlin McHugh, she was our production designer, art designer, and that was her treehouse.
The treehouse was wonderful.
Yeah. We love the treehouse.
Yeah. So that was her treehouse. And when we first got to the treehouse to kind of look at the location, it was just filled with twigs and leaves and trees and nobody had been in it for like many, many years. And then she made it look incredible. And that was all her, you know, art design coming in and making it look like a really nice, safe space for Monica. And so she, you know, I've known her for years and years and she just did a really great job of, you know, coming in, we shot in my childhood home and she would be like, oh, everything looks great. But then she would switch a couple pictures around or, you know, add a new table or add, you know, a blanket here and there. And then my mom would be like cleaning along the way. And be like, no, you can't like move the vase from there to there to be clean. And my mom would try to just be cleaning like on the fly. You know, the house is never clean enough for guests. So we had to kind of stop my mom from just like, we're like, everything is good as is. Like, don't worry. Don't try to make it look nicer.
Wow, that's pretty brave of your mom to allow you to shoot in her house.
Yeah, it was pretty brave of both my parents. We had to kind of send them away for a couple days because we just took over the house, you know. And then,
that was smart. That was smart.
Yes.
Yes. And then when they came back,
I do art. I've done art and production design, and I'm like, the owners, let's just give them a vacation. Really. Need them to see how we're gonna treat their house. And we bring it back nicely, but let's just be honest, you know, a film shoot is very difficult on a house or a location.
Everyone was pretty respectful about the house, though. Like, you know, we're an Indian household where you can't wear shoes inside. you know, so everyone was cool about like leaving their shoes outside or putting those booty things over their shoes if they really wanted to wear their shoes. So, I mean, the cast and crew were very respectful in terms of that.
We had a lot of fun. It was a good time there.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you say that. That's a good segue because I wanted to say that it really shows that you were having a good time on that set. And it really shows how much love there was. And, you know, you put so much attention to details. You also put your heart and soul in it. And it's so nice to have this kind of storytelling of people of kind of, you know, Desis living in the West, you know, and a really true, authentic story of first and second generation South Asians. Now, I just wanted to ask you, like, when you were doing the editing process, did you get any feedback from any other filmmakers? Were there any, I know you mentioned Monsoon Wedding, but were there any other corollary films that you were inspired by for your filmmaking? And Ritesh and Anna, if you, you know, Ritesh, you said you were looking at some other performances to be informed. So is there any other films that you watched or that informed your work?
Yeah, so definitely in terms of the filmmaking and in even the writing process, I am a huge fan of just independent film in general. So I love the Duplass Brothers films and three really specific films that I drew upon were sibling dramas/dramedies like The Skeleton Twins, You Can Count on Me, and The Savages. And those really informed the story of the film and also how I wanted it to be very grounded, very authentic. And a lot of the times when I do watch these indie films that I love, they happen to have, you know, white characters and white family members. And so I was like, oh, I want to make a movie like that, but with a South Asian American family centered around it instead. And so that was definitely the gem of inspiration that came from, like, I definitely wanted a sibling dramedy that I could watch with faces that were brown and instead of white.
Yeah, I remember I asked Sujata, you know, tonally, what, you know, who would you compare what you're going for to, just so I could go in with a sense of what part of a whole I was, or what whole I was a part of. And she mentioned a bunch of different filmmakers, and I watched the films that she just mentioned, and which I had seen before. And then also I remember watching The Florida Project. You had brought that up, and that was really
that was
helpful. Yeah, because then I understood that you were going for something, you know, just first of all, what powerful work can be made with a low budget, you know, handheld and just so naturalistic, almost like, you know, docu style. And so that really helped me understand where I was allowed to go with the character of Jaya and to make her just a little more like internalized and personal.
You know, for me, it was more about really discussing with Suj, because it kind of so much hanged on these explosions or these pivotal moments for the character in terms of dealing with his mental health. I wanted to make sure that I was never going over the top. So when I was watching other performances, or say when I'm looking at other performances, I don't necessarily look for them for inspiration, but more so sort of where they lie, just because everyone's demon per se is unique to the character. So I don't like to pull too much from other performances, because then I get their flavor when this is a completely unique situation in a unique family with unique surroundings, you know. So a lot of it is like, okay, so here's someone who's dealing with mental illness, but it's not recognized by the family. So how does that affect the way that he bursts out in rage or sadness, or where's that imbalance coming from? So for me, it was really sitting down with Suj, focusing on the motivation that causes these outbreaks. And so really focusing on what the cause was instead of the effect, and focusing on the cause then ultimately leads to that sort of effect that we were looking for.
I think these are such incredible insights. And honestly, since I saw the film, I just had a million questions, because I'm a filmmaker as well. And I just really wanted to get into as much of your process and all the work that you did and how you accomplished this beautiful feat. So I want to once again thank you for that. What's next for you all?
So I've been pretty productive over quarantine. I wrote my second feature and
congratulations.
Thank you. I also wrote a pilot, which I'm in development at a really great production company. And I have another show in development at a major studio. And these all center Indian American characters and situations. And it's been good. I've just been developing stuff. And once we get out of coronavirus period of time, then I would just really love to get back right into production again.
Wow, this is the best time for a writer director.
Yeah.
To get all her ducks in a row. It sounds like you've got a lot going on for yourself. What about Anna and Ritesh? How has it been for you guys? And what do you think is going to come up next for you?
I wrote a pilot during the quarantine time, and I've started another one. And I also have one of the leads in a feature film called Rumble Strip, which was released on October 20th, and you can find it on streaming platforms pretty much everywhere. And also, I'm going to be heading to Atlanta to work on a TV show called The Resident.
Nice.
Yeah. Well, I said, what up?
Who?
Manish.
My son.
Is he playing your son? You know, just a quick story. I did my first professional job with Manish, and you him did? And I... We did a print ad for a new Pepsi can for India. I don't know if he remembers. We can bring it up and tell him.
He definitely knows all about the movie and he's excited to see it. So.
Oh, for sure. Good. I'm so glad to hear that. No, we haven't crossed paths yet. So.
Well, that's great.
I'm currently pitching a show. So hopefully we'll have good news down the road about that. And I recently... just had an animated movie come out on Netflix, Barbie's Dreamhouse Princess Adventures. I'm the voice of Ken. So Barbie and Ken, I'm the voice of. So on Netflix, so check it out. Ken is, Malcolm Ken is an Indian guy. He's a South Indian guy. I don't know if you guys knew
what?
That.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
I love
you didn't know this, but like Ken.
Of representation of what we're going for.
I know.
Dosa idli sambar, Ken's favorite foods. So,
are you Gujarati?
No, I'm Tamil. Yeah, I'm South Indian. Yeah.
Nice.
I hope you guys are all staying safe and surviving COVID. Okay, and I just want to really thank you for sharing your really important and beautiful film with us. We are so delighted to have had you here. Please do watch the other films. Our festival goes from the 4th of December to the 12th of December this year. And we would like to invite you to please enjoy the other films and share your thoughts on social media and spread the word with all your friends. And we want to thank all our viewers and all our festival team and staff and our sponsors for being so generous and so kind. But most of all, we would really want to thank our filmmakers who are working so hard to make these incredible movies. Please, if you love this movie, talk about it on social media, tell people about it, get the word out that important cinema is being made and produced, directed, acted by these outstanding, incredible, incredible talent who are, in North America and living their best life through their art. Thank you and goodbye.